celebrate the International Day of the Child, because as we know, many people like to complain about the inefficiency of the United Nations and the, you know, states pay their contributions but they don't get anything in return. We have to remember that the UN was established to achieve many objectives, but mostly maintenance of international peace and security and assisting member states to ensure the human rights of its citizens without any discrimination as to gender, religion, racial origin, ability, whatever. No discrimination whatsoever. And I think Eleanor Roosevelt, who took the initiative to put together the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, has given the UN a historical opportunity that the UN adopted the Universal Declaration for Human Rights. And this Universal Declaration of Human Rights is not a binding, is not a legally binding document, but it has a great moral value that every state has adhered to this Universal Declaration. And this Universal Declaration was translated into a number of UN human rights conventions: the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, and then different conventions to guarantee the rights of the most vulnerable groups, starting by women, people with disabilities, migrant workers, victims of forced disappearance, racial discrimination, and children. So to celebrate the International Day of the Child here really means a lot. Mrs. Steiner spoke about female genital mutilation. one-to-one meetings with Mandela or luncheons, and he came to the residence. I was really honored to have listened to his stories, and I have seen what he did for children. The first thing he did when he became president was to establish the Nelson Mandela Children Fund, and he donated his salary to help children go to school, enjoy their lives. So I came back from South Africa as Assistant Minister of Foreign Affairs, and then was the big change in my life, where I was appointed with the rank of a minister to be the head of the National Council for Childhood and Motherhood. And this is where my life really changed. Instead of rubbing shoulders with heads of states and ministers of foreign affairs, I went to the most remote areas and spent all my time with the most vulnerable and victims of violence, exclusion, and marginalization. And this is really where I used all my diplomatic skills to convince these families that what they were doing was not in the best interest of their children. And I owe it to them that they believed. And together, we were able to speak about these taboos that were untouchables, and people started to say, this is bad, we will not do it. How did they do it? When we provided the information. And I must tell you, female genital mutilation, child marriage, whatever, is not practiced by any religion alone. It is a cultural practice. So you will find in a geographic location all followers of different religions, non-believers, you name it, do the same thing. So if you think it's only Muslims or only Christians or only Jews or non-believers, wrong. There is no religion that calls for violence or abuse. It's how some people would like to translate or interpret religion. So really, it's very important to educate people. The first line of defense against these horrendous crimes is to educate the mentioned